So what I'm going to present tonight is, again, I just moved here a year ago, but it's my adopted community, and so I want to talk about a place-based initiative here, not some global thing or some huge involvement, but focus on Rhinecliff, about, you know, families and kids. And I've tentatively named it Be Cool Rhinecliff, because our major challenge is heat. So it would be nice to come together and protect the community, our friends, families, and neighbors, and especially the kids. This is Matt and Estelle, and my new hero, Sam, learning the guitar. And for me, this is what it's all about. So after some brief opening remarks, where I'm almost done, I'm going to spend 20 or 25 minutes on the heart of the presentation. And if you hold your questions until 7:30, when the questions and comments period ends, I would appreciate it, just so I can kind of get through this in a timely way. And then we'll talk a few minutes before closing about how we might go forward. So there's a sign-in sheet here. I'm going to just pass it around, because I don't think everybody signed in. And if you would do that, I would greatly appreciate it. Thanks, Jen. And I'm going to be writing a blog, and so, you know, one of the things to check is when you want to copy the blog, you know, on occasion, maybe once a month, something like that. I think that's important going forward, because there's a lot happening. If you mute your cell phones, that'd be great. I already mentioned videotaping. So this is a chance right now, right here, to become undistracted. We don't have any emails to do, we don't need to call, we don't have anybody to see except ourselves right here. So just being here may give us an opportunity to look at some things that are very important to us, but we just haven't taken the time because life is busy and that's the way it works. Okay, I'm going to spend a few minutes about me, then I'm going to spend the bulk of the remaining time on what our challenge is. I think you'll find that pretty fascinating. And then what needs our attention here in Rhinecliff? So I was born in Brooklyn. I have a master's in community planning, which is helpful, because even though this is about action, planning is involved. For 10 years, I was a housing project manager for the District of Columbia's housing and community planning department. I spent 4 years with my wife, Sunny, designing and building and working with an architect to get a green home built to build green New Mexico standards, similar to the U.S. Green Building Council. And then for the 4 years that Sandy mentioned, I'm former director of the Office of Sustainability in Silver City. We worked on large-scale solar, as in 3,000 solar panels at the wastewater treatment plant to help offset about 40% of the energy that was required to process wastewater. And roughly July of last year, I came back from New Mexico after 2021. Unfortunately, my dear wife, Sunny, died of a heart attack while she was hiking in the Gila National Forest, which she loved to do. And so I had sisters here, and my sister Maria and Ambassador Rosemary. Would you please give it up for my sister? Nobody has fabulous sisters like I do. Nobody. And you owe me a slice of pepperoni for the acknowledgement. Okay. Okay, what I'm about to get into in terms of the truth as I see it, the main slide, the next one, is not about my opinion. It's based on expert opinion and the sources that I hold to determine truth from my own perspective. Because the only thing I can really do if I want to work on something is, you know, look out there and, you know, see what's true, what's real. Because if I don't know what's real, I don't know what to do about it. So I wanted to present what was happening in the climate throughout the 21st century, where most of our children are going to be living. because when 2050 happens and we start to enter what I would call, and this is my term, but you'll see why in a little bit, when we enter the killing field of heat, especially at 3, 4, 5 degrees Celsius, that's a time when we wouldn't want to be around, and we certainly wouldn't want our children to pass through that, because at that point their life is threatened. So I'm going to go through that with you and what I'm basing this on. So in terms of climate experts, and you're listening, I've got a fabulous 6-minute, very recent video of Professor Schellenhuber, basically saying this is what's happening, this is where it's going, and these are the implications. And he is arguably the most renowned climate scientist in the world. He's a theoretical physicist. He was a personal consultant to Angela Merkel when she was head of the Department of the Environment in Germany. She was also a theoretical physicist, interestingly enough. And Schellenhuber also consulted to her when she became the Chancellor of Germany, as you know. And he is personally responsible for the amount of solar voltaics that have been deployed in Germany, which is unheard of. I mean, they don't have New Mexico sunshine. But they are about, last time I looked, it was over 60% of their total energy needs supplied by solar. Unbelievable. I'll mention Kevin Anderson at Tinsdale Institute briefly. Then, of course, the Washington Post Climate Group, Sarah Kaplan, and Chris Mooney, Pulitzer Prize winning climate reporter. And, of course, NASA, the organization that got us to the moon. Okay, as I mentioned before, our challenge collectively is sustained ongoing heat throughout the 21st century. It's not going to go away, it's going to continue to increase. NASA said this July was the hottest in the last 143 years. And I encourage anybody, I mean, you can Google this, and I encourage you to look for yourself if you really are interested in this in general. You can determine what your own truth is. It's all available on Google. And you can read and say, hey, I agree with this, I don't agree with that. See what makes sense to you. So basically 1 degree of Celsius, the world, the humanity has been supported in terms of the growth, birth and growth of the human race for millennia. And we are now at 1.1 degree Celsius warming above what has kept us sustained. So we are now in uncharted territory. The world has never been this warm for millennia. Now the years at the end there in red, I'm pretending to make this real, that I have a daughter who's 10 years old today. And she is going to live throughout the century. And let's see what happens. So in 2032, the UN has said, as reported by Sarah Kaplan in the Post, that the world is on the brink of catastrophic climate change. Why? Because we are about to burn through the carbon budget that supports 1.5 degrees Celsius, which was the most ambitious climate target or goal that was set in the Paris Climate Accords back in 2015. And so that basically, that's going to happen. It is now too late, 9 years out, to make the drastic cuts that Secretary General, UN Secretary General Guterres says are needed to avoid blowing through 1.5 degrees. So that's going to happen for sure. Part of the problem, as you all know, is since we have waited so late, the amount of change economically, financially, emotionally, everything would collapse not only our society, but many other societies. It's too steep a hill, and there would be riots in the street. It's just not, it's, not politically tenable at this point. Okay, 2050, at that point in 2032, my daughter is now 19. 2050, we are now projected to be 2 degrees centigrade, where NASA says there will be additional compounding effects of climate risk as one climate aspect of sea level rise affects another one, which might have to do with migration of climate refugees, which might have to do with more difficulty to grow food, et cetera, et cetera. So these are compounding, in some cases, some people use the term cascading effects, and Professor Schellhuber will talk about that in a minute. So this, that red line is something we don't want to see any child cross. And why? Because the children are our future, you know, and we have many children in this community. We don't want to see them threatened, which they will be unless we take some action here. So 2060, I don't know if you're familiar with Richard Leakey, the famous paleoanthropologist. I sat 50 feet from him in 2003 at the Grosvenor Auditorium of the National Geographic headquarters in DC. And I was there, and, you know, we thought he was going to talk about what he's famous for. That's just, he's the Kenyan, but about, you know, the elephants and the wildlife reserves and that kind of thing, which he did. And then he started to get into this, that, and was five past mass extinctions. Now, I was not aware of mass extinctions before he got up on the stage. So he starts talking about, he and associates have looked at when the sixth mass extinction is going to occur. And he says, it's going to be around 2060. Therefore, I fell off my chair and picked myself up. You know, I said, my God, that's not that far away. And he's talking about an extinction of millions of species, not just animals, plants, whatever. And it's already beginning to happen. I mean, you can Google this also. We are losing now like a million species annually because of the change in the climate, and it will worsen. So, the other thing that really struck me, and it wasn't in 2003, it was 2016, he was giving an interview on TV. And in response to the interviewer, he said, what's the world going to do with 2 billion climate refugees? 2 billion with a B. So, imagine, if you will, what happened with the 1 million climate refugees from the war and agricultural failure, et cetera, in Syria, not that long ago. And so you had 1 million people move, and a number of countries attempted to take them, some did, but most of the citizens of those countries didn't want them. Especially in Germany, Merkel wanted to take quite a few, she did. But there was major unrest. So now imagine, because he's 2 billion climate refugees, he's talking about the second half of the century. Imagine as climate degrades in all aspects, and now you have 2 billion climate refugees. What the world is going to do with them is worse than what happened with the 1 million, because in the coming years, nations are going to say, we have already too much to be able to protect our own citizens. We can't afford to protect anymore. And if people try to get in, those citizens of those countries would physically remove them. So what's going to happen to directly answer Leakey's question? What's the world going to do with 2 billion refugees? Mostly nothing, which means that probably most of them will die. And that's a period where that will just contribute to mass deaths. In 2050, 2070 and 2100, again, this is my term, the killing heat. But Kevin Anderson of the Tyndall Institute, who I mentioned earlier, he said as early as 2009, he said, I think it's extremely unlikely that we wouldn't have mass death at 4 degrees C. If you have got a population of 9 billion by 2050, and you hit 4, 5, or 6 degrees C, you might have half a billion people surviving. So the question is, obviously, what happened to the other 8.5 billion people? Okay, now at this point, 2070, my daughter is now 57. She's still got another roughly 30 years to live. If any of you have fallen asleep, this is really worthwhile. Slapping your face, this is really good.
You are probably one of the most recognized climate scientists in the world, and you are the father of the phrase tipping points.
Mm.
Could you explain what is actually a tipping point?
Mm. The really important part of the planetary machinery, which can be pushed into a new mode of operation, or we can